Good morning. It's good to worship with you this morning. Today we're going to be looking at God's grace that places us in a covenantal relationship with Him. Let's begin by praying and inviting Holy Spirit to come and be a part of us and what we're doing. So Holy Spirit, we do invite you to come and be our teacher, our guide, our counselor today. Father God, we thank you for all that you have done and for your plans that you have for each of us. This morning, we ask for your wisdom and understanding to be clearly stated. Lord, regardless of what I say or do, make your words, make your understanding, make your message for this morning clear. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Over the last few months, I have been reminding Kara how many blogs I have left as I approach leaving Dayton. This morning, this will be my next to the last time to preach here at Hope. This morning, we're going to conclude a set of grace sermons, a set of three, that I have done over the last couple of years. Even though this particular grace sermon is a little bit out of order. What I mean by that is God works in our lives in an orderly manner, but all of God's grace is one grace. It's not like He has different buckets of grace that He pulls out when He works with us. There's just one grace. But in order for us to better understand that grace, we have broken it up into sections describing how each section of grace works in our lives to ensure that we have a relationship with Him. First, He calls us to Himself by His prevenient grace. Some time ago, we talked about this prevenient grace, the facet of God's grace that calls us or woos us or draws us to Himself until we can turn and face Him and enter into the next facet of His grace, which is justifying grace. While doing this set of three grace sermons, I skipped justifying grace so that I could save it for some of the last and final things that I have to say here. So we skipped justifying grace and went on to sanctifying grace, the perfecting grace of God's work through Holy Spirit in our lives. Now you may ask, why in the world would you teach them out of order? Well, actually, I have two reasons for doing that. First is because I trusted that you could follow and understand that prevenient grace, the calling of God, comes before the justifying grace, the saving of God, and then leads into sanctifying, the perfecting of God. And as I thought about these last sermons, I wanted to make sure that the most important things about faith that I had to say would be the things that I would say at the very end. Now, all of Scripture is important. In fact, Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 3:16, all of Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, correcting, rebuking, and training in righteousness. So the message of the entire Bible is important, but there are a few key messages that must be grasped in order to be able to embrace all of Scripture. So, I ask, what would be the most important thing I could say in this and then the next sermon? And the message of justifying grace is just about as important a message as you can hear. It is the salvation message. You must be born again. More than just being a believer, you have to be made new, born again, transformed, changed from one family to another. Now, I know that the phrase being born again is not very popular right now, but it is the phrase that Jesus taught. It's how He said what happens in justifying grace. It's being born again, being born into this new family of God. It's in surrendering to Jesus and embracing Him that we, and what He's done, that we enter into the kingdom of heaven, where we live a godly purpose and life is possible. So the grace sermons have been a little bit out of order, but it was so I could say this one last time, surrender to God's justifying grace so that you may have life abundantly. understanding, and thriving in the movement and rhythm of God in our lives is God's grace at work and our response to what He's doing. So this morning we're going to focus on justifying grace, the part of God's love that He lavishes on us. Now, I accepted this justifying grace when I was just 6 years old. My grandfather was preaching a revival and gave an altar call. I knew that I wanted Jesus to live in my heart, so I went forward to receive Him. At that point, I was saved, but I didn't fully understand what it meant to be justified. At that young age, I didn't grasp all that Jesus did for us on the cross. I simply knew that Jesus loved me, that I loved Him, and that I wanted Him to live in my heart. However, many years later, one morning while reading my Bible and trying to understand this concept of justifying grace at an adult level, I became increasingly aware of how far short I fell of God's perfection, which is sin. Sometimes we like to place sin with the things done in the dark, but any time we fall short of God's holiness, we are sinning. On this particular morning, I sat frozen in the depth of my own unworthiness to be called a child of God. It seemed as though nothing I did was of any value. Sitting there with my Bible in hand, looking at the holiness of Christ, I became aware of how everything in my life fell short of His holiness. All I could do was to hold my head and ask the question, "Lord, I am so sinful, I don't deserve You. How can this be?" In answer to my cries and desire to understand justifying grace, God granted me an understanding of that grace through a vision. Suddenly in my mind, I was standing before the brightest, most pure light I've ever seen. It was so bright that I can't describe it to you. It wasn't harsh to look at, like the sun, and there was no hint of color. It was more like a fluorescent light, only more pure and more intense. And as I stood there before that light, which I understood to be Jesus Christ, I became aware that I was wearing something that looked like a trench coat. And on this trench coat hung what looked like canteens. And I knew that the canteens represented my sin. Jesus then asked me to take off the coat, and beneath the coat, I saw that within me was the light that stood in front of me. In an instant, I understood that it was not my righteousness that made me acceptable or justified to be in a relationship with the only true God. There was nothing I could do to merit the relationship. It wasn't something I worked my way into. It was a gift of God through the grace of Jesus Christ. All I had to do was to accept this grace-filled righteousness. And then the Lord gave me a verse of Scripture to go with the vision from Romans 1, chapter 1, verse 17. "For in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith." You see, God accepts us at our worst, and through Christ offers us a relationship with Him through His justifying grace. Now, the central theme of the Bible is God's deep desire to be in a relationship with those that He has created. We know that the creation story in Genesis 1, God created all that is around us, day, night, sky, seas, vegetation, stars, sun, moon, all of it, the living creatures of the water and the birds of the sky and the land animals. And then He created humans, the only part of His creation that is created in His image. In that first little bit of time, the relationship between God and humanity was pristine. It was as He intended it to be. But then by chapter 3, we know that Adam and Eve rebelled. They chose wrong. They chose self-desire over God's plan. And a separation between God and His creation immediately came into play. Before their sin, there was no dividing wall between God and humans. Unfortunately, with that one wrong choice, Adam and Eve set forever a dividing wall between God and his creation. It's something that still must be dealt with even today. All of us are born into this separation that Adam and Eve caused. While Paul wrote in the book of Romans chapter 5, verse 12, Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people because all sinned. So we are in a double whammy, so to speak. We are born into a sin nature because of Adam and Eve, and then we willfully choose to rebel against God's ways and do life on our own. Yet God didn't give up. He set out to bring us back to himself through the grace found in his Son, Jesus Christ. The separation from God leaves a void in our lives, and humanity, all of humanity, we all become quite good at trying to look at other things to fulfill that void that's caused by that separation. We may try things that are good for us, like family, career, or a pursuit of a dream to change the world around us, or to champion for the poor and the oppressed. While those things are good and worthy of our time, they won't fulfill the longing for a relationship with God. Sometimes we try to avoid that, we try to fill that void with destructive choices like illicit sex, drugs of all kinds, and the misuse of power. But neither will those things fill the void left by the separation caused by our sin of wrong choice, choosing self over God. Our need for that relationship with God is so deep that it drives us to try many things, sometimes even including trying systems of religious rules and regulations to make the connection. We attempt to be the right person that makes God happy by doing the right things. Our attention is tuned to rules and for living, not the freedom of loving and being loved by our God. In our own power, we cannot mend the damage done to our relationship with God caused by our sinfulness. But what we can't do by ourselves, God, through his justifying grace in Jesus Christ, does for us. For when Christ went to the cross and offered his life as an offering for us, justifying grace was made available to all who would accept it. Justifying grace is the grace of God at work in our lives the moment we say in faith yes to the relationship God offers us through Christ. The Apostle Paul writes in Romans chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace which we now stand. Justifying grace cleanses us from all sin and impurity and makes us, to quote Billy Graham, just as though we had never sinned. Justifying grace is the work of God in our lives when we turn from our self-will and embrace the loving, free relationship with God in Jesus Christ and say yes to him with our whole being. John wrote in 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 and 10, This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is true love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. So on the cross, we see God's power of love for us. God has said yes to us and begins to pursue us with his prevenient grace. Jesus Christ went to the cross in order to be able to live with us in justifying grace, and we begin to live in justifying grace when we say yes to him. And then God sends his sanctifying grace to work in our lives by the power of Holy Spirit, transforming our nation, our nature from sin into God's holiness. God does not offer us things. Yet sometimes that's what we seek from him. God doesn't offer us things. He offers us a relationship The scriptures call it a covenant relationship, where God places himself in a binding agreement to be our God and to accept us as his people when we say yes to his Son. Justifying grace is also known as salvation or healing, conversion, having one's sins forgiven, and being born again. Whatever you call it, justifying grace is living a new life, moving from death to life. Jesus said in John chapter 1, verse 2, "Truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged. He has crossed over from death to life." So we are clear. How do we receive God's justifying grace? Simply put, by saying yes to Jesus through faith. We do not, nor cannot, earn God's love. We can never become good enough to enter into the relationship with God by our own merit. Romans 3:23 states, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." Each of us miss God's holy mark and stand before him with a trench coat, with canteens of sin. There is no difference. All have sinned. All of us have chosen self over God and lived the way we wanted, not the way God intended or blesses. All of us have wanted a bite of the apple and have suffered the alienation of God. All of us have sinned and fallen short of his glory. But Paul goes on to say that all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Jesus Christ. God in his love, through the power of Jesus, cleans up our lives after we come to him in faith. I heard a Christian comedian describe the process by asking this question: do you have to get cleaned up to take a bath? Of course, the answer is no, we don't have to get cleaned up to take a bath. Neither do we have to clean up our lives before we come to Christ. The fact is, it's impossible for us to get cleaned up enough to go to God on our own. I have a justifying grace story to tell you. It's an unlikely conversion story, but it's a conversion all the same. This was my dog, Hannah. She died in 2013, and this is a picture of her when she was 14 years old. She looks kind of ragged, and that's because she had all kinds of skin tags and couldn't be groomed properly. But when we found her in the shelter when she was only 2 years old, she had the potential to be beautiful. We found her in a no-kill shelter, and when I first saw her, she was an absolute mess. Her hair had grown out and made her face look something other than what she was. She had mats all over her body. She had lain in feces that was on the cement floor of her cage, so she smelled absolutely horrible. She looked very sad and lonely. She was extremely underweight and sick. She was dying. When I first saw her, I immediately knew the value in her because I knew what she was. She was a full-blooded Cocker Spaniel, and I understood that breed. I had had several Cockers before her. So I understood the value in her, but her circumstances around her didn't care about that. Now, I'm not talking about the people who were running the shelter. They were doing the best that they could with the number of animals they were trying to take care of. I'm talking about her living conditions, what she was enduring. The cement that she was laying on didn't care what she was. She had no way of getting herself out of the mess she was in. She couldn't change her circumstances. She couldn't get a bath or a haircut. She didn't have access to more food or power to find a better place to live. I, on the other hand, had the power and authority to change her life. I looked through all that filth. I ignored the smell and the mats, knowing I had the ability to clean her up and make her mine if she would say yes to me. So we took her out of the kennel, and she did say yes to me, and so I claimed her as my own. But listen carefully, I claimed her as mine while she was filthy, smelling horrible, and looking pitiful. While she was dying in her circumstances, I claimed her, and then after she became mine, after she responded to choosing me, after I had paid the price for her. She was taken out of general population, scrubbed, groomed, placed in a clean kennel all of her own in another room, and made ready to begin her new life in a relationship with me. From the moment I claimed her and she responded yes, she remained mine until she died. While in a relationship with me, though she never got that filthy again, I did have to give her baths and groom her from time to time. Listen carefully. I enjoyed doing that for her because I loved her and wanted to continue to make her life with me all that it could be. God's justifying grace acts the same in our lives. He chooses us because he knows the value in us. We are made in his image, and he wants us to be with him. He chooses us while we are filthy, covered with our sins, living in intolerable, unholy places, lonely, depressed, and dying. Romans 5:8 says that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That's the moment of his choosing us. Once we say yes to him, accepting the life he offers, his justifying grace works in our lives as he scrubs us and grooms us, as he cleanses us from all the sin and unrighteousness and begins the relationship with us, which is our initial conversion that sets us in relationship with him, where Jesus is our righteousness. And like Hannah, we never get that dirty again, but as we grow in Christ, understanding ourselves and God's better, and we seek more of God in our lives, we do need to be cleansed over and over so his justifying grace continues to work throughout our lives in small little conversions because we continue to need his cleansing and grooming. The Bible calls that pruning. So God accepts us just as we are, but he never leaves us that way. Through faith, then, we accept all that Christ has done for us and we commit ourselves to him. The faith that Jesus asks of us is that we trust him and abandon our self-reliance in our own strength because we really can't get out of the cage of sin and death on our own. He knows that and asks that we commit ourselves to his power and his guiding word. For what we can't do by ourselves on the cross, through justifying grace, he did for us. So say yes, yes, to God's justifying grace that bathes us in the love of God in Jesus Christ and cleanses us on the inside, ushering us into a covenantal relationship with the God of the universe, the only true God, the God who loves each of us completely. Let's pray. Father God, there is no way for us to completely thank you for all that you have done for us. Lord, what we can do, though, is surrender our lives to you, is to say yes overwhelmingly to you. Yes, 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 Lord God, for you love us and we desire to be in a relationship with you. So come, come, Holy Spirit, wherever we are, whatever time of the week it is, come and speak to us this justifying grace that we may say yes to the Lord and live the abundant life that he has prepared for us. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. If you are in need of prayer, you can contact the church office and someone will get back to you if you leave a message or will be there throughout the week. You can also go to our website where you can find out our contact info. There's also a place for you to send in prayer requests there on the website. The website is www.hopeindayton.org. While you're there, you can check out the church. You can turn in any prayer requests, and you can also give there on the website or through the app or by texting to give, mailing it into the church, or visiting us here on the church campus. We'd like for you to have a great week, and we'll see you next week, either online or in person.
Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Oh, take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, well, set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life. In awe of your name, your mighty love stands strong to the end. You will fulfill your purpose for me. You won't forsake me, you will be with me. Here I am, God, arms wide open. Oh, Here I am, God, arms wide open. Pouring out my life, gracefully broken.